Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Abigail Bottome, and I'm a member of the Worship and Music Committee. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. If you're not familiar with the building, please reach out to one of the greeters if you have questions. The first part of our service is recorded. Following the benediction, the recording will end. Then we will go into our candles section, which is not recorded. The service will be posted on our Facebook page and on YouTube. Given concerns about COVID, we will not be serving coffee or other beverages. If you wish to participate in fellowship after the service, we will be gathering here in the sanctuary for conversation. We require members to wear masks while indoors. Again, due to COVID, we are not passing the basket for an offertory at this point. Please place your donations in the basket in the back either before or after the service. First Parish also accepts online offerings, which you can learn more about online on our website. Welcome to our service at First Parish Plymouth. Our service today is led by our minister, Reverend Arthur Lavoie. The sermon is entitled, Finding Joy. Our technical director is Paul Melville. Today's live music will be performed by Sandi Hammond. And our guest musician is Seeger Creane. Welcome, Seeger. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever you believe, wherever you are on your journey, let us walk together this hour. Our call to worship this morning is It's Flung by Reverend Scott Taylor. Joy doesn't simply arise. It flies. It flames. No, it is flung. It is passed. It is spread between you and me, between the one who just received a gift and the one that has been looking for it a long time. It's a beautiful and elegant contagion over which we have more control than we think, if only we share it. If only we notice that joy is not ours to keep, but ours to pass on. So let's light up the world, friends. Joy blesses us with its exuberance.
I've got peace like a river.
Good morning, everyone. I invite everyone to rise as willing and able and join with me in reciting the words to our chalice lighting, which you'll find written in your order of service. Love is the spirit of this church, and service its law. This is our great covenant. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in freedom, to speak the truth in love, and to help one another. Please be seated. So, since Deb is not here today. She's taking a Sunday off. I'm going to be talking to you about these two guys. They are on the picture on the front of your order of service. And many of the adults know who they are, but I bet some of the kids don't know who they are. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about them. On the left here is the Dalai Lama, and he is from Tibet, a country that's like north of India, and he, so a Lama in the Tibetan form of Buddhism is the head of a monastery and a whole territory, and it's like kind of a bishop in the Catholic or Episcopal churches. The Dalai Lama is like the Pope. He is the head spiritual leader of the whole country. And several years ago, almost 50 years ago now, the Chinese invaded, China invaded Tibet and took over the country and started harassing and persecuting people in the country, and the Dalai Lama had to flee. He and some of his followers had to flee, and they had set up a government like in India. And he knows that so many people back in his country, in Tibet, are being harassed and persecuted, and it is a huge, huge burden that he has to carry, also knowing that when he dies, there might be a civil war because the Chinese government will try to appoint the next Dalai Lama and not let the spiritual leaders in the country do that. Over here, on the right, you have Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Now, he's from South Africa, the most southern country on the African continent. And in South Africa, for many years, there was a small group of white citizens that controlled the government and controlled the whole country, and the vast majority of the population, which was black African, were oppressed, were not allowed to vote, lived in extreme poverty. There was a lot of violence as people tried to fight for their rights. And Archbishop Tutu, who was a leader in the Episcopal Church, which was the main church in that area, was part of the kind of spiritual leadership that alerted the world to what was going on so that world leaders and countries boycotted South Africa and opposed such sanctions that they had to change their form of government. And then he led a committee in South Africa called the Truth and Reconciliation Committee. He put that together so that people in South Africa could tell their stories, and so that people who were perpetrators of violence could be held accountable in some way. So here are two men who have been through hell and back, really, and who, as you can see in this picture, they're dancing. Their lives are filled with joy. In fact, this was taken at a party. So when the Dalai Lama turned 80 a few years ago, Archbishop Tutu came and spent a week with him. And the result of that week is this book called The Book of Joy, which I'm going to talk to the adults about today. And here are two people who have probably experienced among the worst things that people could experience, and yet they have been able to live lives filled with joy, to find joy in their lives. Now, this is taking place at this birthday party that they threw for the Dalai Lama is taking place at a school in Dharamsala, which is the place in India where he lives, and it's a school that was started to teach Tibetan children the original ways of their culture and their people. So there are children who are being smuggled from Tibet down into India so that they can study at the school and they don't see their families for years. And the Dalai Lama is a very active presence in the school, and he helped support and the kids. And so he decided that his party would actually be at the school with all, I think there are a couple thousand children at the school. You know, so that's where this is taking place. So it's they're a wonderful example to all of us about how we can move out of the places of pain and struggle, whatever is our experience, and move toward living lives filled with joy. Yeah. So I want to thank Sharon. Sharon is gonna go up with the children today, and Jesse's here and Joe is here, so we'll now sing the children up to their classes in the parish house.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Speaking with you this morning. Again, my name is the Reverend Arthur Lavoie. I didn't introduce myself earlier. My pronouns are he, him, and his. And I want to especially say a few words to the people who are not physically present with us this morning, but who are going to be watching the service on our YouTube channel, on Facebook, and on PAC TV. We want to welcome you to be part of our service this morning and make sure that you feel connected with the rest of us who are physically present here. We invite you, if you would like to know more about Unitarian Universalism or how First Parish in Plymouth operates, please feel free to call our office and to get in contact with me through the office. Or my email address is on our website. And so it would be really nice to connect with you in person. And if you feel comfortable doing so, to attend a service here at First Parish. And again, a reminder to everyone that we are not doing a physical offering at this time, but there is a basket in the back of the sanctuary. Thank you.
Our reading this morning is from the Book of Joy. And it's an excerpt from You Are a Masterpiece in the Making. It is very simple, said the Dalai Lama. Everyone knows that physical pain is bad and tries to avoid it. We do this not only by curing diseases, but also by trying to prevent them and by trying to keep our physical immunity strong. Mental pain is equally bad, so we should try to alleviate it as well. The way to do this is to develop mental immunity. Mental immunity is learning to avoid the destructive emotions and to develop the positive ones. First, we must understand the mind. The diverse thoughts and emotions we experience on a daily basis. Some of these thoughts and emotions are harmful, even toxic, while others are healthy and healing. The former disturb our mind and cause much mental pain. The latter bring us true joyfulness. Think about it this way. If your health is strong, when viruses come, they will not make you sick. If your overall health is weak, even small viruses will be very dangerous for you. Similarly, if your mental health is sound, when disturbances come, you will have some distress but quickly recover. If your mental health is not good, then small disturbances, small problems, will cause you much pain and suffering. You will have much fear and worry, much sadness and despair, and much anger and aggravation. People would like to be able to take a pill that makes their fear and anxiety go away and makes them immediately feel peaceful. This is impossible. One must develop the mind over time and cultivate mental immunity.
Our lovely Reverend Art Lavoie that brings you joy.
Thank you, Sandi. You might know someone in your life that who exudes a kind of joy that I was talking about a little earlier with the kids. Level of joy and happiness that they possess in spite of the struggles and the hardships that they've endured. The person that comes to my mind was my tia. She was my great aunt, the widow of my grandmother's brother. Now, tia, as you might know, is the Spanish, and in my family, the Portuguese word for aunt. Even though her given name was Maria, everyone in town knew her as tia. And I mean that literally. She worked in a restaurant, and everyone who walked in called her tia, greeted her. She knew many of the regulars by name and greeted them back. She had had 3 miscarriages and was not able to bear children. Then her husband, my great uncle, her beloved Tony, died young in an industrial accident at the plant where he worked. That could have been enough to make someone angry and bitter for the rest of their lives. But somehow, she was able to continue on with her life. Somehow she was able to find meaning and joy and a generosity of spirit in being everyone's aunt, everyone's tia. She and I had an especially close relationship because I was born on her birthday. And from the time I was young, we always celebrated our birthdays together. I believe the purpose of life is to find happiness, writes the Dalai Lama. This is the great question that underlies our existence, because the ultimate source of happiness is within us. Sadly, he continues, many of the things that undermine our joy and our happiness we create ourselves. The suffering from a natural disaster we cannot control, but the suffering from daily disasters we can. We create most of our suffering, so it should be logical that we also have the ability to create more joy. One of the phrases that came up in the book a few times is that pain is inevitable, but suffering is optional. It is what we do with pain and hardship that will make the difference in our ability to find renewed meaning and purpose in life. And whether we like it or not, suffering, some kind of emotional pain, can either break our spirits or can teach us compassion, can help us understand more deeply the suffering and hardship of others and empathize with their pain. When we speak of experiencing happiness, said the Dalai Lama, we need to know that there are actually 2 different kinds. The first is the enjoyment of pleasure through our senses. But we can also experience happiness at the deeper level through our mind, such as through love, compassion, and generosity. What characterizes happiness at this deeper level is the sense of fulfillment that we experience. While the joy of the senses is brief, The joy at this deeper level is much longer lasting. It is true joy. In the reading that Abigail shared with us this morning, the Dalai Lama talks about developing mental immunity. Here are some of the steps that the two of them, the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Tutu, outline as part of the process of developing mental immunity. First, they suggest that we have to accept ourselves as we are. Yes, we can work to improve, to change some unhealthy practices and behaviors, but that can only begin when we have an accurate assessment of who we really are. It's then important for us to get to know the things that trigger us, that engage some of our anger, our grief, our despair. We've all had some difficult or traumatic experiences over the course of our lives. That leaves tender places in us, tender states that easily take us to negative and unhealthy places. The more we know about those buttons, those tender places, the more we can avoid them and remember that the current situation or experience that might be triggering us is not the one that caused the trauma. They also suggest that part of developing mental immunity involves the recognition that we are all human, that we all make mistakes. With this recognition, we can release ourselves from shame, which is probably the most debilitating of all of our mental or emotional states. Archbishop Tutu says that difficult and painful experiences are only made more intense with the glue of guilt and shame. I love that he called it the glue, like guilt and shame, how it binds to us and binds us to negative thoughts and perceptions, mostly about ourselves. But we don't have to dwell on them. We can accept and understand and then let them go. In Buddhist teaching, the first step to accept the reality of suffering, dukkha, is the Sanskrit word that can be translated as stress, anxiety, suffering, or dissatisfaction. There is much dukkha, or suffering, that comes from our attempt to control our thoughts, emotions, and the experiences that produce these. When reality doesn't match our desires, we often suffer. Acceptance is part of the response that will free us from dukkha. The Dalai Lama says, we have perceptions about our experience and we judge them. This is good, this is bad. Then we have responses, fear, frustration, anger, to what we consider to be bad. We realize that these are just different aspects of mind. They are not actual reality. Similarly, fearlessness, kindness, love, and forgiveness are also aspects of our mind and our thinking that we can rely on. The Dalai Lama and Archbishop Tutu identified several obstacles to joy, those states of mind and heart that cause us to hold on to the things that harm us. Those obstacles are fear, stress, anxiety, frustration and anger, sadness and grief, despair, loneliness, envy, suffering and adversity, and illness and the fear of death. These stand in the way of realizing our potential and living our most fulfilling lives. I think we all know the things that block us from being happy and from finding joy. We each have our own piece of some of those emotional states I just mentioned. But what I want to focus on in the rest of the sermon is what they have identified as the eight pillars of joy. Those states of mind and heart that renew our spirits and give us strength and fulfillment. The first pillar of joy is our perspective toward life. Now, we know there are different ways we can look at the things that happen, different angles through which we can see life events. Do we see life as fundamentally good? Or do we think that God or the universe or other people are out to get us? Viktor Frankl, who wrote Man's Search for Meaning out of his experiences in a Nazi concentration camp, wrote that perspective toward life is our final and ultimate freedom. We can choose how we will interpret the things that happen to us. We can choose to be fixated on a certain outcome or find meaning and purpose, whatever happens. And I don't want to make that sound easy. This is not an exercise in Pollyanna theology here. But it is possible. Creating a wider perspective leads us out of our own self-centeredness and opens us to the thoughts and feelings of others. There is a Tibetan prayer that illustrates our second pillar of joy, humility. May I never feel superior from the depth of my heart. May I be able to really appreciate the other person in front of me. Humility comes from the Latin word humus, for earth or soil. Humility brings us back down to earth, quite literally, when we get too haughty and arrogant. And we know that pride can be one of our greatest sins. Humility is the recognition that our gifts are from God or some spiritual source, as are the gifts that have been given to others. Humility allows us to recognize our own limitations and know when to ask for help. And humility can never be confused with timidity. When we're timid, we defer to others and don't own and use our own gifts. Humility is a powerful tool in being able to connect with others through the gifts that we have been given. As I mentioned, the Latin word humus, or earth, is the root of humility. It is also the root of humor, our third pillar of joy. A sense of humor allows us to be secure enough in ourselves to laugh at our foibles and not take ourselves too seriously. With a sense of humor, it is easier to accept situations that don't go the way we had planned. All of the great spiritual teachers had a sense of humor. And this can actually be a sign of deep spiritual development. The only place where change can begin is with acceptance, and this is our fourth pillar of joy. We will always have pain and imperfection. We will always have times of struggle. It's not that we should never get angry or grieve our losses. The joy comes when we can let go and move through the difficult times and difficult emotions and find new meaning and purpose, a new direction. When Bishop Tutu organized and led the Truth and Reconciliation Committee in South Africa at the end of the apartheid regime, he was constantly amazed at the level of forgiveness that was expressed. People needed, we all need our truth to be heard. And once our truth is heard, it is so much easier to let go of the burden of the horrible things that we witness or experience. Forgiveness, then, is our fifth pillar, and it frees us from the past. We forgive not so much for the person who has harmed us. We forgive so that we are not holding on to the burden of that anger or that resentment, that heavy chains of whatever has been done to us. The ability to forgive does not mean that we forget. It does not mean that we put ourselves in similar unsafe circumstances. We always can seek justice for ourselves and others, but we can also forgive as a way to remove a burden from our own souls. Gratitude is the sixth pillar. And gratitude is the recognition of all that holds us in the web of life and all that has made possible, had made it possible for us to be who we are today. It's the ability to see wonder and surprise and possibility in all that we do and all that we come in contact with. According to the Dalai Lama, we can be grateful even for our enemies because they can be our most precious spiritual teachers. That's one to dwell on. If too much self-centered thinking is the source of much of our suffering, then compassion or thinking of others can bring us more happiness. And compassion is the seventh pillar of joy. Compassion literally means that we have the ability to suffer with another. Not that we take their pain and grief, but that we can understand what they are going through. And we can companion them. We can, by our presence, let them know that they are not alone. And our last pillar of joy is generosity, especially a generosity of spirit. Now, at this time of year, we have the story of Ebenezer Scrooge in Dickens' Christmas Carol, who's become the iconic character to show us how much joy can come by letting go of our miserly, self-focused lives. We, like him, can open ourselves to small and large acts of kindness and generosity that can make lives better, ours and those of other people. So So I don't know about you, but I would have loved to have been there to dance with Bishop Tutu and the Dalai Lama. That must have been quite a thing. And while that is happening, Archbishop Tutu is on his second round of treatment for prostate cancer. And yet there he is dancing. And I think a special gift that they and all spiritual leaders have is this kind of aura of how they are in the world. I think people go to see them, not only for what they have to say, but for this presence that they possess. It's electrifying. Not because of their pain and struggle, but because of what their lives have taught them about finding meaning and happiness and joy. They embody the deepest spirituality and their presence and their joy can be infectious for all of us. Amen. And blessed be. Now, speaking of joy, we can't have this service without including one of the other more iconic images of joy, a version of Beethoven's Ode to Joy that is in our hymnal. And probably the Ninth Symphony can be said to be one of the most beautiful, incredible pieces of music that's ever been written. And yet, we are also mindful that at the time of that writing, Beethoven was profoundly deaf. And yet wrote something that will continue to live through the ages. A hymn to joy. So the version that's printed in our order of service is one of the three versions of that song that's in our hymnal. It is not the original. The original poem that Beethoven used was a hymn to the goddess, actually. Joy thou goddess, fair immortal, is how that one starts. This is the words are by Henry Van Dyke, or Henry Van Dyke. And I invite people to mouth the words. We're still not yet singing here in the sanctuary, but Sandi will play and sing, and please follow along, hum along, mouth the words, join in however you like.
Melt the clouds of sin and
Our reading this morning that Abigail shared was from the Dalai Lama. Our benediction is from referring to some of the writings of Archbishop Tutu, who has taught us about an important theological term in South African religious thinking, and it's called Ubuntu, U-B-U-N-T-U. And I have mentioned that in sermons before. Ubuntu is this South African word that can be basically translated as a person is a person through other people. We are meant to be profoundly connected and profoundly complementary. And that's the thought I want to leave us with as we go forward, because joy and happiness are not something we can achieve fully by ourselves. We have to be engaged with others. We have to understand the God-given spiritual gifts, and if nothing else, be engaged with the spiritual power that feeds our souls, and that then can shine out through us to everyone around us. So I wish us all this morning a sense of Ubuntu to take with us as we leave.